glad that Candy and the gang didn't decide to sing Lead Me to the Cross before I had to come up here. Does that just destroy everyone in this room? That song is just insane. It's there's one line in it that's a fresh reminder, a good reminder, like, bring me to my knees. That's a good place to be. It's a good place to be. Every time you meet with God, every time you crack open his word, it should bring you to your knees. Should bring you to your knees. I think I may have, I often forget everything I say, so bear with me. I may have said it just a moment ago. I know I mentioned it to the band when we were praying earlier, but this week, and especially today, even as I was parking the car and driving up, I was reminded of what I do. And I was reminded of the privilege that it is to actually be a guy that gets to spend that much time in God's Word, and then to be able to have the privilege of presenting this to you. And as I was walking up from the parking lot, I started thinking about, you know, the amazing men, you know, like Spurgeon and Tozer and Jonathan Edwards, and in our modern day, you know, like guys like Billy Graham and I mean, just John MacArthur, R.C. Sproul. I mean, just these amazing men of God that I've, and I'm not alone, I'm sure, I listen to them and I'm like, wow, like that's Adrian Rogers, you know, Chuck Swindoll, these amazing men of God. And then it hits you like, man, I get to do that. Like, that is an amazing privilege. And I'm refreshed every time I get up here. And I'm also reminded of the privilege that it is. And listen, a guy can sit on a soapbox all day and have no one to talk to. I am privileged, trust me, graced of God to have people sitting in front of me right now. And I don't take it lightly. And I'm appreciative of it. I also know that there's other people in this community and the churches right around us that are going to get up tomorrow, do the same exact thing. And it's a, you know, it's a big deal. It's a huge deal. It's a huge deal. As a matter of fact, the Bible even talks about that guys like me, we have to give an account to what we tell you. You don't have to give an account to what you tell me. I have to give an account to what I tell you. Like, you have to give an account to what you believe, you know, and that's why I encourage you all the time, crack open a Bible. I might not be right. But listen, you don't have to give an account for what you tell me. I have to give an account. Like, what did you do with Robert? Jesus is going to look at me one day, you know, like, that's coming. What did you do with Robert? Did you tell him what I told you to? Did you? Like, that's coming. For every single person that's ever walked into this building, that question's coming for me. And I understand the weight of that. But I also understand the privilege that goes along with it. And so I just want to take a moment and I want to ask God to help me. And then I also want to ask God to help those that are about to preach, our brothers in the Lord and our churches right here in our community here in Eustis. And we will be meeting Monday the 7th in our Harmony group to discuss how we can together serve our Eustis community better as a family of faith, not just one certain denomination, but all of us together. So if I could ask you to pray with me real quick, then we'll crack open our Bibles and we'll see what God has to say to us tonight. Father, I am, like I've said, I just shared with my loved ones here, I am aware of the importance of your word. It's the greatest treasure that you left. I mean, it's an amazing gift of, I don't even know how to, like, it's an incredible, awesome, amazing gift that you've left us. You have exalted your word above all things, and you have ordained that men would stand up and preach your word, that people who are on fire for you would preach your word to the people. And so, Lord, I'm thankful. I'm thankful that you give me the privilege to do this. You've been giving me this privilege for several years, and I hope and pray you'll continue to allow me this privilege to do this. But right now, Lord, I just want to bring to your attention the other folks in our community. I want to bring to your attention those pastors that are here in our churches, in our community, that are going to, that are right now even in their offices, you know, burning the midnight oil, if you will, trying to desperately hear from you so that they could pass on some wisdom to the people that will come to their church in the morning. And some of them aren't ready. They're not ready. They haven't heard clearly from you. Lord, I pray that you would. You'd speak to them now, that your Spirit would invade their heart and invade their mind right now and give them the message that the people in those churches need to hear, that your kingdom might advance in their heart, in their church, in this community, in this world. And so I pray for them, Lord, all of our brothers that are toiling and working diligently in the seat waiting to hear from you. Speak to them clearly. I thank you for that, Lord, and I just pray that you'll help me with this message. And I pray for everyone in this room right now, Lord, that the same Spirit that gave the message would be the same Spirit that conditions the heart of everyone in this room right now to hear from you. Let them not hear my voice. Let them hear yours. I thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. So we started a message series, getting ready for Christmas. Anyone ready for Christmas yet? Who's bought all their gifts already?
Done.
You got some done already, huh? You're almost done? You're almost done?
Done.
You're done. You just what? I'm not going to buy anything. I like that. That's a good approach. It's cheap. I like that. I like that. Yeah, there you go. There you go. Well, I saw a video the other day of a Walmart. I don't know if you guys saw it, that just like 1,500 people in front of a Walmart, and they opened the doors and they trampled people. It's crazy. Christmas is coming. It's a crazy time of year. But we want to celebrate. We want to celebrate for different reasons. It's not just Santa Claus and Rudolph. We want to turn our attention to the Lord Jesus. We want to do that every single day, every single moment. But you know what? God has given us this day that we can just make it a special day and turn our focus to Jesus. And it's not all that Jesus ever was, this baby Jesus that came, you know, the Ricky Bobby Jesus. That's a good Jesus. But he grew up and he did some things and he's still doing some things even right now. And so really what we want to do in this series is to figure out what in the world Jesus came for, what he came to do, what he's doing right now. And then, you know, of course, that gives us some purpose too, because we're his bride, right? We're his body. You know, Christ was the visible image of the invisible God. Well, then he ascended to the right hand of the Father. So we are the visible image of the invisible Christ. That's us, right? So we have to find some purpose. We got to find some purpose, and that was the whole reason for this message series. Last week we started in the Gospel of Luke, and we examined that one section where Jesus opens up the scroll and he's standing in front of all the people in the temple, and he says that the Spirit of God is upon me, and he's anointed me to preach the good news to the poor, which was who?
Me.
Everyone. It was everyone. And to heal the brokenhearted, which was who?
Everyone.
Yeah, and the blind would see, which is who?
Everyone.
Right? And then he would set at liberty those who have been bruised. Remember the old serpent bruising our heel and kind of injuring us? We're still working, but we're malfunctioning. We're kind of walking with a limp through life as people, not really functioning the way God made us to function. And he came to set us at liberty, free from that influence of the evil one in our lives. And that's what we examined last week. And this week, we're going to examine two verses. And we're going to see through this careful examination of God's word that Jesus was and is actively on mission then and now. Here's the two verses, Luke 19:10. Go to Luke 19, if you want to read the little story, just to give you some context. Luke 19:10, and then we're also going to see the next verse. We're going to find that in Mark, not Mark Highland, the book of Mark Highland. No. That would be an extremely interesting read. Luke 19, okay? Luke 19, who went to Sunday school as a kid? Raise your hand. Okay, I didn't. Jewish guy over here, okay? Don't hate. Okay, you guys remember the little guy Zacchaeus? Does anyone remember that song?
Uh-huh.
Only Mary went to Sunday school. Who grew up watching, looking at the flannel board? Flannel board? No flannel board, kids? Mimi still has hers. If you needed to bust it out, she'll use it. Here's the story. This is the little Zacchaeus guy. Ready? You guys ready to read God's word? Okay, Luke 19. You ready? Verse 1. It's a story about Zacchaeus. Jesus entered Jericho. That was a busy city. That was a popular city. You guys remember what happened there? What happened there? Ah! And the walls fell down, right? Okay. Jesus entered Jericho and made his way through the town. There was a man there named Zacchaeus. He was the chief tax collector in the region. That means chief hated guy. Chief hated guy. And he had become very rich at the expense of his fellow countrymen. He tried to get a look at Jesus, but he was a wee little man, right? Too short. Maybe this is the book of Mark. No, I'm just kidding. To see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore / fig tree beside the road, for Jesus was going to pass that way. See, Jesus had been performing miracles, and people just wanted to check it out, right? He was a rock star coming through town, and they wanted to see him. So they're climbing up. You can almost envision like the Beatles or the Rolling Stones, or in today's world, I don't even know who the most popular guy is, but you know, people go crazy to see him. And this is what's happening here, because Jesus is now, his fame is growing like crazy. So he's climbing up in the tree just to see him. When Jesus came by, he looked up at Zacchaeus and called him by name. That's huge. Called him by name. Zacchaeus, he said, quick, come down. I must be a guest in your home today. Zacchaeus quickly climbed down and took Jesus to his house in great excitement and joy. But the people were displeased. He has gone to be the guest of a notorious sinner, they grumbled. Meanwhile, Zacchaeus stood before the Lord, and he said, I will give half my wealth to the poor, Lord. And if I've cheated people on their taxes, I will give them back four times as much. See, something had happened in this dude, right? Something happened in this guy. You could see it. It was fleshing out. What had happened inside, it was now showing on the outside. And so Jesus responds. He notices because God sees the heart. Amen? And he says, salvation has come to this home today, for this man has shown himself to be a true son of Abraham. And here's our quote. For the Son of Man, Jesus, came to seek and save those who are lost. That's why he came down from heaven, to seek and save those who are lost. Here's the other verse we're going to talk about. I'm not going to give you the whole story there, but it's Mark 2:17 in the King James. I came to call sinners to repentance. I've come to call sinners to repentance. Now there's a lot of churchy words in here that I've read to you. I've said to you, seek and save and lost and call and repent. And we're gonna kind of tear those words apart a little bit so we can understand what it is that Jesus came for. Because everybody has an opinion as to who Jesus is, who Jesus was, and why Jesus came. And so, but Jesus clarifies in scripture why he came. Like, we don't need commentaries. Did you know that? Did you know you don't need a commentary? Did you know that you don't need anyone, including me? You can open up the Bible and Jesus Christ himself will tell you exactly why he came to this earth. And he just did. He came in red ink to seek and save that which is lost and to call sinners to repentance. So let's talk about the first thing here. Let's talk about seeking. You know, I've been doing this now for about 12 years or so, and I can tell you that over those 12 years, I've had several people walk in the front door one time or another and ask about the church. You know, like when you're not getting ready for a service, just like during the week when you're doing stuff, and they'll ask you a variety of different questions to get the heartbeat of the church, find out what it's all about. They'll ask you if you're this kind of church. They'll ask you if you're that kind of church. Do you do this? Do you do that? Are you an outreach? Are you inward-focused? Outward-focused? Do you dunk? Do you sprinkle? Do you this, that? Okay, and one of the questions that I've gotten 100 times, and maybe you guys have heard this before, are you a seeker-sensitive church? Have you guys ever heard of that? A seeker-sensitive church? Okay, well, listen, we try the very best of our ability to make it comfy. I mean, we got rid of the wooden chairs, right? Yeah, right? So, but they, I mean, they were nice chairs. I mean, y'all ate them, you used them at Red Lobster and you didn't complain about it. But you know what I'm saying? But you know, if I had a lobster tail in front of you, you'd be chowing down for like, the service is over? What? Bring me some more. But we do try, of course, to make it comfy and cozy, right? So that when you come, there's no like distraction from what's being presented to you. So it is nice and cozy and comfortable. But are we seeker sensitive? That's the question. And I would tell you that absolutely no, we're not seeker sensitive. You know why? Because the Bible tells us that no one is seeking God. No one. No. The Bible says in Romans chapter 3:11, no one is seeking God. No one is seeking God. Not a single person on earth is truly seeking God. Now, for clarification, this is about the non-believer. Before you came to Christ. Now, if you've come to Christ, I'm hoping that that has changed, that the momentum of your stream is now going this way instead of that way. But nobody's seeking God. So to have a church that's modeled to be seeker sensitive, you're thinking, well, you know what? They're coming in looking for this. No, they're not. How many people before they came to Christ were really genuinely like wanting to repent of sin and be a good boy and find God? No, I want to sin. It's fun. Let's go drinking. It is a good time. Sin is fun. Right? That's the nature of people. No one is seeking God, but you know what? Thank goodness. This is a great amen spot. Thank goodness God is seeking you.
Amen.
Okay? John chapter 4, verse 23, it says that the Father is looking for people to worship him in spirit and truth. He's looking for you. We're not looking for him. God is always looking for you. If you've come to Christ, it's because he sought you out and he found you and he grabbed you and he shook you where you were and he opened up the eyes of your heart so that you would say, yes, it has nothing to do with you. You didn't look for it. No one looked for it. No one earned it. No one wanted it. He gave it to you freely on the cross at Calvary. And Jesus Christ, being deity, is always on that mission. You know, when he was a kid, they found him in the temple. What was he doing? Didn't you know I'd be about my Father's business? Didn't you know this is what I was going to be doing? Right? And in John chapter 4, he says, I get my nourishment from doing and completing the work that my Father gave me. That's what Jesus did. Like, he got away sometimes, like, and he rested in prayer. But you know what? That was part of what God, the Father, wanted him to do. He was always at it. He didn't throw ministry in when he had a little free time in his schedule. His schedule was to seek and save that which is lost. The reason he came to this earth was to find you. That's why he came. He's always serving the Lord enthusiastically. I love this. You know, the guys in the men's group, we've been studying this Romans chapter 12. We're going to do 12 weeks in Romans chapter 12. And the challenge that I gave the guys, and I think some of us are doing it, is that I want to see if we will read Romans chapter 12 every day for 12 weeks. That's 144 times to read Romans chapter 12. And one of the parts in Romans chapter 12 that just really speaks to me is over in chapter 12, verse 11. And this is what it says. Paul says, never be lazy, but work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically. Like it's a call. Let's do this, man. Let's do this. Serve the Lord enthusiastically. And our model is Jesus Christ himself. He served the Lord enthusiastically. It was an all-day, everyday mission that he was on to seek and save that which was lost. He didn't rest. That's what he did. That's who he is. He's serving the Lord enthusiastically, and so we should seek and save that which is lost. We see evidence of this in Romans 5:8, where he says, you know, that he showed us great love, that he sent his son to die for you. While you were a sinner, like you weren't looking for him, but I was looking for you. And so I sent my eyes down to save you. These are my eyes in the person of my son to come down and find you and save you and offer you the kingdom. And that's what he did. I'm not looking, but God is. You know, there's some big words that are used here. Seek and save those who are lost. Call sinners to repentance. Church words.
You know, he called to seek, and he came to seek and to save. You know, now I'm not trying to like douse you with a bunch of knowledge because I don't have a whole lot, but save is the word sozo in Greek. And it means to not just to save something like before it's going to spoil. No, it's to heal something. It's to deliver someone from something. It's to make whole again. Remember, the snake bit you in the heel and he injured you and you're broken. And Jesus said, I've come to fix that thing, that chasm between you and God. I am here to fit in the middle of that void, to fill that void, to heal that problem. Now, the other thing is to save that which is lost. To save that which was lost. You know, I mentioned Kyle earlier. Every week he'd come in here and he'd lose his keys. Every week. Every week we'd have to go looking for his keys. And that's, I lost my keys. Listen, it's not about losing your keys. Hey, where did I put my keys, man? Did you guys, where's my wallet? See, the word lost is not just, hey, where's my purse, man? Where I left my hat somewhere. Where, you know? It's more than that. You see, unless you understand the depravity, unless you understand the deep hole that you were in, you'll never understand and appreciate the amazing gift that God has given you. How deep and dark it is for you. Here's another Greek word, again, not trying to dazzle. Apolumi. Apolumi. Okay, that's lost. And it's not just, oh, I can't find my keys. It carries this definition. Fully destroyed. Fully destroyed, fully perished. Like, you're not just dead, you're so dead. You're so dead, you're beyond flatline, you're dead. You're dead, and that's why you can't seek God and you can't find God. You know why? Because you're dead. Everyone's dead. Have you ever seen a dead man go looking for something? He can't. He's dead. His eyes don't work. You're dead, and that's what it means to be fully destroyed and perished. It goes on in the definition to say that it's a complete cessation or departure from God. Dead. You can't save yourself. There's nothing. Do you feel the hopelessness in that? That's a good hopelessness. I hope that you feel it. Because if you feel it and you've been saved, you understand how awesome it is, the gift that you got when you're totally, totally dead. This is what God has been doing. He's been calling people to himself. That's what he's doing when he seeks. He calls us. Just like he did to Zacchaeus. He calls you by name. Zacchaeus! Donna! That's what he's doing. Yo, Donna! I'm over here. Hey, Greg! Frankie! That's what he's doing. He's calling people who are not looking for him. And he's going, I'm over here. Come to me. I have something better for you. He's been doing it since way, way back. We see it in Exodus chapter 3, verse 4. Burning bush. You ever heard that one, right? What happens? Moses. God's calling him. Moses, I have a greater purpose for your life. Come here. Let me share that with you. Calling by name, calling people who were not looking for him. In 1 Samuel chapter 3, 4 times, Samuel's trying to go to sleep. Do you ever have a tough night's sleep when you cannot go to sleep? Yeah? Well, how would you like God, while you're trying desperately to fall asleep, going, Samuel! 4 times, he called Samuel by name. That's comforting. He calls us by name. We're not looking for him, but he's looking for us. Do me a favor, go to Romans chapter 8, verse 29. Bless you. Romans chapter 8, verse 29. This is a highly debated section of scripture. You ready to read? We're talking about God calling people, right? Well, Romans 8:28 says that we know all things work out for the good to those who love the Lord and are what? Called to his purpose, right? He cracks open the window a little bit there. He's talking about calling. Now look what it says.
for God knew his people in advance. Now, can we just pause there for a second? There's an argument in Christianity, and everyone has their side. I got mine, you got yours. Everyone's got theirs. But here's the thing. There's this whole idea of predestination, and some people are chosen and some people are not. And people that say that predestiny is right here. Okay? Now I'm going to ask you a question. I think that you're all intelligent people. No, I do. I sincerely do. Let me ask you a question. For God knew his people in advance, and he chose them to become like his son, so that his son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. How many people on this earth, what is there, 7 billion people? 7 billion? How many people on the earth right now, and let's just say maybe 100 years ago, maybe there was 5 billion people? I don't know. How many people that were living did God know about when they were born? All, right? Let me ask you a question. How about 500 years ago? How many of those people that got born that year kind of slipped through the cracks and God went, whoa? No. How'd that happen? Must have been an immaculate conception that I wasn't a part of. The worst, most wretched human being on earth. God knows who he is. Listen, God, for those God foreknew. I'm just saying that I don't care about commentaries and this and that. Look, he knew everybody, right? He knew every single person. And if he's the one true God, how many of the people on this earth does he truly want to worship him? Okay. Draw your own conclusions, and you have the right to do that. For God knew his people in advance, and he chose them to become like his son, so that his son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And having chosen them, look at this, he called them to come to him. You see, this is nothing new. Exodus, 1 Samuel, Romans, he called them to come to him. And having called them, he gave them right standing with himself. So after he called them, said, hey, Robert, and Robert came, he gave them right standing through the death of Christ on the cross. And having given them right standing, he gave them whose glory? Their own? His glory. His glory. You don't get any of your own glory. Do you understand that? It's his glory. Every bit of glory in the universe is owned by God. It's not yours. It's not mine. It's no one's. It's his. And if you're fortunate enough, he'll give you a shred of it. He'll share a little bit of his glory with you. It's not yours. But this is you can see this. He is called listen, this is just my belief system. It's not the gospel. This is what I believe, having read that he is called who? Everybody, right? Everyone on earth. He wants every single person to worship him. Look over in Mark chapter 1, verse 16 through 19. It says that he went around on the beach and he saw Andrew and Peter. And what did he do? He called them. Jesus in the flesh, right? Comes down and he calls them by name and says, hey, listen, same thing that he did through the burning bush. Moses, come, I've got purpose for your life. I want to do something through and with you. And what did he do to the disciples? Listen, I want to change your life. I've got purpose for you. Come see me. Put down the fishing nets for fish. That's good. Let me show you great. And we're going to fish for men. I'm going to give you purpose in life. Mark chapter 3, it goes on. It says that he called the rest of the 12. He called them to himself. And then, of course, like we read at first, he calls Zacchaeus to himself. So here's the part where you get to be involved in the sermon, right? Finish my sentence for me. So if Romans 8:29 says that we're to be like his son, right, and the son is calling people, then we should be calling people. You got it. You got it. It gives us greater purpose. We are here to call people to the Lord. That's why we live. That's the reason why we're here, is to call people to the Lord. And so that's why in 2 Corinthians 5:20, Paul says that God is making his appeal through us. Do you understand the weight now when I was sharing earlier about the weight of what I'm doing? Do you understand that the weight of what I'm doing is also on your shoulders? And also on your shoulders, I don't know you, but it's on your shoulders.
It's on your shoulders. Every one of us, it's on. If you've received the grace of God, then the weight and the duty of making the appeal to the world is on your shoulders. He makes his appeal through who? Point to the person he's making the appeal through. Listen, it's you. It's you. He's making his appeal through you. We speak. Crazy. Listen. You speak, Mike, for the creator of the universe. You should fall over right now. That's crazy. You speak for the creator of the universe. Out of your mouth comes his word and his plea to repentance and faith and salvation comes from your mouth. God uses us. Romans 8, 13 through 14 basically says this. How can they believe and be saved unless what? Unless someone tells them. You have to tell them about this. Where you work, where you live, where you shop, where you worship. That sounds crazy. I'll make a deal with you. I'll take the lion's share of this joint, but I can't do it at your work. Do you understand? I can't do that. I wish that I could, you know, pastor day. You bring your, and we could evangelize. You know, like show and tell. Hey, I want you to meet the guy who yells at me for an hour every week. We're buddies. That's awesome. Right? Listen, I want to pick some people. I'm going to pick you, okay? I'm going to pick you, and I'm going to pick you. Okay, I want you to do me a favor. Someone who's not on that list, pull out their cell phone and go to a calculator. Please. You ready? Okay. I want you to do, how many people, before I ask the question, how many people would love to see, when they come in here on a Saturday night, that the seats are, you're looking for a seat, you can't find one, and everyone that comes in here is just like absolutely going crazy for the Lord. They love the Lord, they've totally changed their life, they're worshiping him like crazy, they're out serving here, they're evangelizing out there, like crazy Jesus freaks, the whole joint. Would you like that? I would like that. I would like, it's gonna be awesome. Okay, now look, tell me how many, you got the calculator? How many people do you touch a day? Think about this for a moment. Your family, your work, your neighbors. Just throw a random number out.
I'm going to say about 35.
35. Who else did I pick? Joey. When you're out and about, how many people? I'm talking airport, lunch, on the assembly line there where you're building stuff, your coworkers, the contractors, the people that run the plants. Average day. 150 people. Awesome. What's up, Rome? Scotty? Who else did I pick? Eileen, how many people? 25 to 30. Who else? How many people? 60 people. Okay, did I pick anybody else? That was it. How many people is that total? How much? Okay, this sanctuary holds 92 people. There's your church. You just named them right there. God's making his plea through you. I can't do it for you. I don't even know where you work. I don't even know where you live. I can't do it, but you can. He's chosen you to make his plea to your, how many? 30, 60? 35 people. 35 people. You could change their eternity. You could. I can't. I don't even know who they are. 150 people. He was in Canada last week. How many people are going to go to Canada this week to go work on an asphalt plant in the middle of nothing? That's where he was. Who's going to reach those people? Me? Dan? No. Who's going to do it? Joey's going to do it. There's a church. He's got a whole congregation. He's got 150 people himself. Awesome. Awesome privilege and weight and duty. Duty, duty, duty. It's our duty. God calls people with your mouth, in your people, in your people, in your people. everyone's people. Everyone. We touch so many people in our lives every single day in all the places that we go, and the opportunity is presented to you to share the good news with people. Paul said, pray for us that God would give us opportunities to share the good news, and then also pray that we'll be bold enough so when the time comes, we will open up our mouths. That's what we need to be praying for each other, man. We need to be praying that for each other. So when God's calling people, and then he's using us to call people, what's the call? Sounds good. What's the call? Well, the call is the second verse that I was telling you about, Mark 2:17, to call sinners to repentance. To repentance. Like, that's an old church word. Hey, Moses, I want something fresh. I want something new. No, you don't. You need to learn about repentance. All of us need to learn about repentance. You can't even get saved without repentance and faith. You have to keep going back to repentance, 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 repentance. It will never get old from now until the day Christ cracks open the sky. Repent, repent, repent all the time. That's the call. Do you know that it's the first thing that Jesus ever preached? Repentance. It's the first thing he ever preached. You'll see it in Matthew 4:17. He said, repent and turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is here. And it was him. I'm right here. It's time for you to get it done right now. You need to repent. You need to repent. Let me give you a definition of repentance. It's really, really simple. You don't want to talk about it unless we can understand what it really is. Here's a real basic, if you're a note taker, you can jot this down. It's a great definition. It's simple and easy to remember. You acknowledge that you are wrong. Yep. You're wrong. I'm wrong. That's it. I'm wrong. About what? Everything. I'm wrong. And God, if I'm wrong, you're right. About what? Everything. He created everything. He's got to be right about everything. So God, I acknowledge that I am wrong, and I acknowledge that you are right. And then that is immediately followed by a decision of your will to follow the right guy. That's repentance. That's it. I'm wrong. You're right. I'm doing it your way. I was going this way. Now I'm going that way. That's it. That's the whole thing. That's what repentance is. Let's go back. Remember I said we go way, 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 way back when it talks about the call. Well, it's equally the same when it comes to repentance. We see repentance displayed all through Scripture, so that must be kind of important to God. And let's go to Ezekiel chapter 18. I know there's a couple of Ezekiel fans in here, right?
Yes.
I knew I could get you there, Cindy. An Ezekiel lady. Ezekiel 18. Look at verse 30. This is a way, 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 way back, like almost 800 years before Jesus even shows up. Look at verse 30. Therefore, I, God, will judge each of you, O people of Israel, that's us, according to your actions, not what your wife says, not what your husband does, not how successful your kids are, but yourself. His eyes are on you, not on me, but on you and me, separate. What does he say? Repent and turn from your sins. Now, this is a warning right here. That's advice, but then he gives us a warning like, okay, well, why? Why would I repent? Why would I acknowledge that I am wrong and that you are right and turn from your sin and go after you? Why would I do that? Don't let your sins destroy you. That's why. He wants us to live, not to die. Put all your rebellion behind you. That's a word for someone here. Someone in this room, probably all of us in this room, are rebelling. God's been trying to crack that nut for a long time, and you've got your heels dug in, and I'm not letting go. I like my sin. I like the way I am, and I'm not going to change. If you came into this room and told me face to face with your robe and slippers on, I'm not changing. And he says, listen, repent and turn from your sins. Don't let them destroy you. put all your rebellion behind you and find yourselves a new heart and a new spirit. For why should you die, O people of Israel? I don't want you to die. Do you feel his heart? Do you feel his heart? He doesn't want anybody to die. This is not what he wanted. Turn back and live. This has been going on for a long, long time. We see in Matthew chapter 3, John the Baptist comes before the Lord and he's announcing to the people, repent and turn to God. Mark chapter 6, verse 12, Jesus sends, after he goes from village to village, then he says, all right, guys, this is part of your training. I want you to go village to village and I want you to preach. And guess what he told them to preach? Repent and turn to God. Acts chapter 2, verse 38, Peter preaches his first message. What does he say when everyone goes, well, that's great. What do we do? What does he say? Repent and turn to God. Acts chapter 17, verse 30. Paul, not just Peter, now Paul. I command all people, you all must repent and turn to God. It's been the same message for thousands and thousands of years. People say, well, the world's different now. Culture changes. No, it hasn't. It's exactly the same. You know why? Because he's right and we're wrong. That it was like that 2,000 years ago. It was like that 2,800 years ago. And guess what? It's 2015. It's still the same. We're wrong. And he's right. It never changes. Acts 26:20. Do me a favor. Go there real quick. Acts 26:20. Because there's a little caveat in here that he adds a little bit something to it. Same message though, same thing, repent, repent, repent. 26:20, he says this. This is Luke. I preach first to those in Damascus. He preached there. And I wonder what he preached there. You guys like, do you know? Do you know, right? Then he goes on, he says, I preached there in Damascus, then in Jerusalem, and guess what I preached there, right? And throughout all Judea, and also to the Gentiles. Now listen, that's a lot of preaching, right? That's a lot of preaching in a lot of towns to a lot of people. Was he like stressing out, Lord, you got to give me some new stuff. I need fresh material for these people. Why wasn't he doing that? Why wasn't he pulling out his commentaries? Why wasn't he looking at other people's stuff? Like, why? Because the message is always pertinent. This message never, ever gets old. It's always appropriate all the time. The message is the same. He says, I preach here, I preach there, Damascus, Jerusalem, throughout all Judea. So it wasn't just like a town, it was a region. So let's just call it like Lake County, right? Everywhere. And to the Gentiles, and what was the message? That they all must repent of their sins and turn to God. It's the same message. So when you come to church, you say, you know, preacher, I've heard you say that before. Good. Good. You know, it's good. Peter said it's good to remind you of these things because I'm leaving soon. I'm going to die, and I want to make sure you know this before I leave. Like, if there's one thing God charged me to do, it's so that you know that it's Jesus on the cross. That's it. Like, you got to know this. So he repeats it over and over and over again. Who does something one time and masters it?
Nobody.
Right? And so you need to be over and over and over again. You played sports, right, Michael? Did you get to go to practice once a season? Oh, I got this. No, you practice all the time, right? That's what we do. We practice over and over again. Drill, after practice, weeks and months and years, all the time. And what happens if you quit? Ask someone in the big leagues. They quit practicing, what happens? Gone. What happened to so-and-so? Oh, I don't know. He quit practicing. He thought he had it figured out. He's done. Repent and turn to God. Now look at this. Here's the caveat I was telling you about. And prove they have changed by the good things that they do. Now, I don't want you to think that it's you know, you do stuff and that causes you to be saved. But what this is telling us is that once you repent and you change, right, that you'd be able to see that. That when someone changes their heart, they acknowledge, I'm wrong, you're right, and I'm going to follow you, that's going to look different, right? You're going to look different. You're going to look different. So, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute, but let's just go by this. Let's go by that, and we'll come back to that whole idea. Guess what? Revelation chapter 2, verse 5, Jesus says to the church in Ephesus, I like this stuff, but repent and turn to God. He also says in Revelation 2:16 to the church in Smyrna, repent and turn to God. He also says in Revelation 2:22 to the church in Thyatira, guess what he says? Repent and turn to God. This is a loaded question. You ready for this one? Are you guys ready? He also says in Revelation 3:3 to the church in Sardis, okay, I'm going to give you, this is the last one. That was kind of weak. You ready? He also says in Revelation 3:19 to the church in Laodicea,
repent and turn to God.
Yes, repent and turn to God. See, we changed our name a while back. You know why? This is one of the reasons. Revolution, you know what revolution means? A sudden and momentous shift in the status quo. Well, you know what another way to say that? Repent and turn to God. It's the same thing. Repent and revolt. It's the same thing. A sudden and momentous shift in the status quo. We can't live this way anymore. And it's our duty. It is our job to go tell the world and all those people that you work with, everyone, that there's a different way. God has called you for a greater purpose. You don't have to do this anymore. You could do it this way. I want to tell you all about my Jesus. Please let me. Okay? So in this calling of repentance, in these differing contexts in which repentance is presented to us in Scripture, we see that it's a kind of an initial and a continuous occurrence. Repentance is an initial time and an ongoing occurrence, okay? It's not just once, it's when? Always, okay? Always. The initial is for the non-believer. It's for the non-believer. It kind of goes something like this. It's my whole outlook, my entire perspective, my identity, my priorities, my intention, my purpose, my ideas, my mouth, my thoughts, the reason I wake up in the morning, the reason for living, what's my purpose, why am I here, my worldview, every single thing is what? Wrong. It's wrong. And my throne right here is occupied by something, anyone or anything other than the Lord Christ. And so I change. I acknowledge that I'm wrong. I acknowledge that he's right. And then it's a willful act of my will. I will change. And I, Jesus, I take you down off of your cross and I put you onto my throne, while at the same time I take myself off my throne and I put myself on your cross. That's what we're supposed to do. That's repentance. Now, I said that's continuous also. This is for the believer. See, once you get that thing done, that's kind of cool. That first time you've said, Jesus, you know what? I want you to be the Lord of my life. That's good. But you know, how many in here like would agree with me that even though Jesus is on your throne, some other things like, you know, like if this is the throne and Jesus is on it, sometimes someone tries to creep up on the seat. You got things that creep up on the seat? Anyone? Don't leave me up there. Right? Stuff tries to take Jesus' spot. Yeah, whoa. Whoa. Listen, for the believer, it's a frequent evaluation of the life of Christ that's disclosed in Scripture. And then you lay that life over your own and you say, hey, where are the deviations? Where are the deviations? Where's my deficiencies? Am I praying like Christ? Am I serving like Christ? Am I generous like Christ? Am I submitting to the Father's will like Christ? Am I a life-giving spirit? Am I bringing life to people when they see me? Am I giving them encouragement? Am I pouring into other people's lives like Jesus did? Am I on my knees serving them like Jesus was? Do I pray like him? Do I think like him? Am I acting like Jesus act? How's my compassion? My compassion meter. How's that doing? Am I just saying, you know what, I'll pray for you? Or am I actually actively engaging in someone's life to help them with the pain that I see that they have, like Jesus does? Or am I just a Christian, the typical that nobody likes because they won't pick up a finger to help someone with their problem? How am I doing with that? This kind of repentance is the churches of Revelation type of repentance. This is the type of repentance that we see in 2 Corinthians, where after Paul writes this blistering letter to the church in Corinth, the first letter to the Corinthians, where he says, you're doing everything wrong, quit doing that. He rips them a new one. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, he says, you know what? At first I was kind of bummed out. I shouldn't have done that. I shouldn't have ripped you like that. But you know what? Now I'm not. I'm thinking about this. You know, because that when you start feeling bad about what you were doing, because you read this letter and I blitzed you, and you start feeling bad, and so this is what godly sorrow set in. And it was the godly sorrow that led to repentance. It's that kind of repentance. It's for the believer. It's Jesus, you do have the throne of my life, but people are competing with you. Things are competing with you. Myself, I'm competing with you. And you're not always on my throne. And so someone rips them a new one. But it was a godly sorrow that led to repentance, and that's a good repentance. It's the Colossians 2:6 repentance that says, just as you accepted Christ Jesus, when you came to him initially acknowledging that you were wrong and he was right, and I'm going to follow you, so you must continue to walk in him. So what does that mean? The day you supposedly went to the altar and you gave your life to Christ and you repented of your sin and you acknowledged that you were wrong and that he was right, you did that the first day, guess what? Do it the second day. Do it the third day. Do it every single day. Every day, because we can always do better. We can always be more Christ-like. We can always open up our heart and our mind and say, God, search me and find places that have not yet given up their spot to the Lordship of Jesus. You take over. We could do that all the time. Just as you accepted me, continue to walk in me. Now, earlier I said something in Luke 26:20 about repenting of your sin and then proving that something happened inside of you. Luke 3:8 says something very similar. Assuming we've repented, we've turned from our sin. I was going this way, and I liked my sin, and it was fun, but it was not really getting me anywhere productive, and I realized that it was wrong and that Jesus is right, and so I started following him. Well, Luke 3:8 says this, to bring forth fruit that is worthy of repentance. Bring forth fruit that's worthy of repentance. Like, what does that say? Repentance is huge. It's a huge gift of God. The privilege and the ability to turn from this and turn to him is a privilege given to you by the Almighty. And we should put that in the scale, if you will, and go, man, I can't believe he's given me this opportunity. And so because it's so weighty, it should do something to us. It should change who we are. Bring forth fruit. You know you're going to be able to see it. Did you know that? You'd be able to see it if someone has truly repented. You would see it in their life. It would show, the fruit of their life would show the fact that they have turned from their ways and turned to Jesus. It's a visible change. There's evidence of repentance, and that's what God's saying. And that evidence of repentance is the magnet that brings you an audience to verbally share the good news of Jesus. That's what God uses. When he makes his plea through you, first he uses the evidence of your change to attract people to you. Do you know that Christians have cancer? Right? But when someone has cancer and they're still smiling and you're going, what in the world is wrong with this guy? He should be like freaking out and nervous and whoa, God, why me? Yeah, not my brother Greg. See, Greg never did that. While he was going through his cancer treatment, how you doing? Well, good, by the grace of God. Every week he was here saying that. And that's an amazing testimony. That's an amazing testimony of the work of God in someone. So there's fruit worthy of repentance. You know why? Because if someone has cancer and they don't know the Lord, they're freaking out. I'm going to die. I'm going to die. I'm going to die. I can't believe I'm going to die. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? I need treatment. I need treatment. You know what he's going? If I die, I die. But you know what? I'm probably not going to because the doctors don't understand who my king is. Confidence. You know, it's the guys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Yeah. Like, you know what? You can throw me in this oven. I don't give a rip. My king's going to save me. But even if he doesn't. See, that's confidence. Even if he doesn't. What's the worst thing you're going to do to me? Make me go to heaven? Ooh. We're all freaking out trying to get to heaven. Every single religion in the world is trying to get to heaven. And we have guaranteed heaven. If you've turned from your sin and you've embraced Christ by faith, you are going to heaven. And we hold on to our life right here like it's everything. Why? You got 80 years here. You have 40 million elsewhere. And that's speaking lightly. Why are we so worried about right now? They're going to come get me. That's why he says to fix our eyes on Christ, who's seated at the right hand of the Father in heaven. Like, that's where our thoughts should be. So we got this initial repentance thing done, but there's still some area that needs work, right? This is a believer now. Undue fears, unhealthy habits. You know, the book of Hebrews chapter 12, it says that there's two things. There's weights that slow us down, but then there's sin that trips us up. Two different things. So those are the areas of our life. Like the weights that slow us down are the things that are going to slow us down enough where these nasty sins are going to catch up and bite. The snake is slithering, waiting to find a heel to bite. You need to keep going. Keep moving, right? Don't slow down. There's things that slow us down. Slow us down. It's like the guy who's a massive addict. Do you think that he should go into the bar the next week and witness to the drunks? That's not something that slows you down. That's stupid. Did he drink? No. But that's a way, like you, that could slow you down. That could get you. That could bite, right? If you're like a massive overeater and you just lost, 200 pounds, is putting a chocolate cake in front of your face a sin? But it could be a weight that slows you down. It could slow you down quick enough where if you slow down. Ho, ho, ho. Come to Papa. You know what I'm saying? Like, at first you're like, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. I pray the blood of Christ over that cake. But if you don't keep moving, right? Moses, it's the same as the Lord calling, right? The chocolate cake is calling me, baby. It's the same thing. So there's areas of our life that we need to get rid of those things. Some tempers, character issues. Is your yes, yes? Is your no, no? When you tell someone you're going to do something, can they rely on you? That's the magnet. There's two sides to a magnet, though, isn't there? The magnet that draws people to your Savior, or if you flip the magnet around, it's the one that pushes them away from Jesus so fast to make your head spin. If you tell someone you're going to do something, listen, everyone, I can't speak for another church, just you guys chose to come here tonight. If you tell someone you're going to do something, you do it. Like, we can study and fight about theology. Are you a Calvinist? I don't know. Did you lie to me? That's important. You know what I mean? Are you an Arminian? Do you believe in dispensationalism? I don't know. Can you help me move tomorrow? Yeah, I'll be there at 6. Show up at 6. All right? That's what we do. That's what Christians need to do. In some areas in our life, the psalmist says, "Search my heart, O God, and know my ways. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out anything in me that offends you and lead me along the path of everlasting life." Listen, those words right there should be a staple, a daily staple in the Christ follower's spiritual diet. And the decisions of my will should reflect a conscientious acknowledgement of my error and of God's authority and lordship in my life. It should display in my life. People should see it. They should see it. Do you know that repentance doesn't make Jesus Lord? I'm going to yell. He is Lord. But repentance makes Jesus your Lord. And that's what we're working on. Who's here to work on someone else? No. God's here to work on you. You should be here. I'm in, God. I want to work on me. Not on somebody else. Not on somebody else. If anybody is in Christ, they're a new creation. The old has died. Behold, like I can see a new man. Behold, I can see something, right? That's fruit worthy of repentance. I should see something in my life. If I have changed, it should show. It should show. Check it out. Look over here. I'm new. Should see something over here. There's evidence of repentance. I may not be all that I can be, but I'm certainly not all I used to be. And if that's you, you need to praise God for that. None of us have graduated. None of us have gotten to be all that God wants us to be yet. But if you've embraced Christ, then you're not the same person you were. And we should be thankful. Now, as we come to a close here, I just want to say that, you know, this is the Christmas season. And so, you know, the baby Jesus is coming. And that's what we're kind of going to be celebrating. You know, we got all these little nativity scenes up in people's yards. And Jesus is like some anemic, glow-in-the-dark Casper baby. I don't even understand that. But that's what people put up. But, you know, when Christmas was coming, when Jesus was about to show up in the manger, the angel of the Lord said that Jesus was good news for all people. For all people. And so on that starry night in Bethlehem, God put skin on to heal this separation, this cessation from God, between God and his people, between man and his God. Sin fully separated man. But yet, you know, it's really weird, and we can all acknowledge this, is that we still walk and talk. Like, if you're a Christian and you stood next to a non-Christian, they still walk and they still talk and they still breathe and they still work. I mean, they still do all the same kind of a stuff. But the problem is that they're malfunctioning. We're malfunctioning. And that's what God has called us to through repentance, to stop malfunctioning and to function exactly the way God has provided for you to live. And which will kind of bring us into next week, which he says, "I came that you might have life abundantly." See, that's what he wants. We see a glimpse of that when we see creation in the garden. Like, this is kind of what he wanted for us. But then you take the Garden of Eden and you compare it to Detroit. Something's gone wrong, right? We can all acknowledge this. Something's gone wrong. We're just malfunctioning. So, maybe you've never moved past the part of the Jesus in the manger. Maybe you've acknowledged this Christmas Jesus, but maybe you've never really moved beyond that. That's a good place to start. If that's where you are, I praise God for that he's even grabbed your attention. Can you put these down a little bit? This is the time, just very, very individual, just between you and God. Keep going down. I'll leave my spots on those so I can read. Maybe tonight, you know, just hearing God's word being proclaimed to you, maybe you're just sensing that Jesus is not like baby Ricky Bobby Jesus anymore, that he actually came looking for you. And maybe you've never slowed down long enough to hear the call. Maybe you've never heard him call your name. Maybe you've never stopped and thought about what Jesus did. And maybe you've never audibly heard him say, you know what, hey, so-and-so, come. Come be my follower. Maybe you've never heard that, but maybe tonight, just listening to what we share, maybe you feel like it's your night to repent. Maybe it's your time to just repent. You know what? And again, it's not just it may be the first time. I don't know. Maybe you just heard something that was said, and you just feel like, you know what? Now's my time. I need to repent. So, you know, people. Churches have made it difficult to get saved. You know what I mean? People have made it really difficult to be saved. Like, you got to do this and you got to do that. You can throw that right out the window. I want to do this. You know, when the scriptures say that anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved, like, it doesn't tell you the exact words. Like, what do I got to do? Like, give me the formula. It doesn't say it. So I'm going to do this. If you feel as though that and I want everybody to close their eyes, because I don't want anyone to be looking. If you're that person who says, you know, I think that God wants me to repent and acknowledge that the way I've been living is really not the way it's supposed to be, that I'm wrong and he's right, and I just want to follow Jesus. Like, I'm starting to realize right now, I feel like God's just working me, going, you know what, there's something right about this. Like, for 2,000 years, billions of people have been satisfied with this. Like, there's something to this, and I, no matter what I've done, it's never really worked out. So I want to do this. I want to finally say yes. Well, I'm gonna make it really super easy for you. I'm gonna give you some words, and I'm gonna read from the Bible. And what I'm gonna ask you is, if that's who you are, I'm gonna ask you to just, in your own way, quietly, no one's watching, you don't have to say it out loud, you don't have to raise your hand, you don't have to come to the altar, you don't have to do anything. I'm just gonna say, like, make these words yours. Just pretend they're your words. As I'm saying them, just go, yeah, God, that's me. I want this, God. Those are my words, God. These are the words spoken by David, King David, after he had an affair with Bathsheba, after he slept with another man's wife, and then he had the man killed, and he felt horrible. And he realized that what he was doing was wrong, and he wanted to change. And so these were his words. And if you feel as though this is your time, just make these words yours. This is what it says. Have mercy on me, O God, because of your unfailing love. Because of your great compassion, blot out the stain of my sins. Wash me clean from my guilt. Purify me from my sin. For I recognize my rebellion. It haunts me day and night. Against you and you alone have I sinned. I have done what is evil in your sight. Purify me from my sins, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Whether joyful or a bit reluctant and scared, Jesus, I offer you the throne of my heart. I give you this throne in exchange for your gift of eternal life. For your death on the cross is good news for me. And I acknowledge that on the cross, you and you alone paid the price for my sin. Jesus, I make you my Lord. Stay right there we are. If there was someone in the room that those words were your words, just so you'll know some truth, God and all of his angels in heaven are celebrating right now. Well, perhaps you accepted Jesus Maybe you accepted his gift of eternal life some time ago, but the fruit worthy of repentance hasn't been flourishing in this season of your life. Well, it's kind of time to continuously evaluate, right? So Psalm 139, these may be your words, just like Psalm 51. Lord, I made you the Lord of my life a while ago. But sometimes I get back on my throne that I offered you. Sometimes I let things creep up on that throne that rightfully belongs to you, you alone. And I want to repent. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out anything in me that offends you, and lead me along the path of everlasting life. I'm going to ask you to be still for a moment and let him speak to you.